Hello and welcome to Virtual Learning Network. This e-lecture will be on the subject India, Earliest Times to the 8th Century AD, Block 1, and the unit that will be covered during this session will be Unit 1, where we will talk about India and its physical features. The topics that will be covered during this session will be introduction, physical geography and history, basic physiographical divisions, regional physical features, important topics, and finally the summary. Learning history without geography is incomplete as the concept of space gets lost. The meaning is that to understand history, one has to understand geography. If we don't understand the geography, learning of history will be rather incomplete. India, the subcontinent, has region, and each region has very specific characters. Because of those specific characters, the Indian history has evolved, the language has evolved, and the social organization has evolved gradually. India has actually three distinct physical divisions. The northern boundaries of India are provided by the lofty ranges of the Himalayas, which run almost in a wall-like shape from northwest to northeast. India has the great plains of northern India formed by the basins of three mighty rivers like the Indus, the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra. Down below, India has the Deccan Plateau of Peninsular India, which you can see on the screen, which is geologically very old structure of Indian subcontinent. The Deccan Plateau consists of huge rock blocks of very ancient times. And so we have a very ancient history regarding this place. The difference in art forms also makes one region very distinct from the other because of the obvious facts like the geographical factors, the characters, the weather, the climate, etc. Physical geography and history. As I have already talked about, there is difference in soil. There is difference in topography, rainfall, amount of rainfall or precipitation, climate, that have created a number of distinct, different regions with a very characteristic features by which we can identify that specific place. Physical regions often correspond to cultural region, and therefore we find a varied amount of cultural settlements, cultural characteristics, dances, music, everything is so different from one region to another in secular India. The region differ from one another in even crop pattern, even population density. The reason being that many of the regions are associated with some rivers. The regions which are associated with rivers naturally have more population than those regions which has less population. For example, in some areas like Uttar Pradesh or Bihar, there is a lot of fertile land which is known as Ganga Valley, which has got very high population concentration. Whereas if we go towards the mountains towards the Himalayas, or we go, it's very sparsely populated because the inhabitation, the habitat condition is not so good. The land is not so fertile. The living is a little bit difficult. So naturally we have less population as compared to the population in the plains. Talking more about physical geography, let's talk about environment and human settlement. The Sindh today, which covers a little bit of Gujarat, is relatively warm and dry because rainfall in this region is very low. But earlier, it was not so. And therefore, the ancient Harappan civilization flourished in that region. So we can see that there is a very good relationship between the physical geography, the human settlement, the settlement pattern, the evolution of that particular area. So it's not that the region which is at present dry, for example Rajasthan, we do have some portion of Rajasthan in the Harappan civilization, which clearly means that though it is dry today, it was not so dry earlier. Now let's talk about what is the argument that goes against geographical determinism. There is definitely a very strong relationship between the physical features and the unfolding of the historical process in a region, which I was talking about in the earlier slides in this particular session. Understanding of geographical factors helps us to understand the cultural development, as I've already talked about, and it has been argued that nature determines the route of development while man determines the rate and the state, which means that as the climate changes, the development pattern also changes. Man can only be instrumental in the rate of development or where he can flourish, but he cannot determine the natural changes of a particular region. So actually, in a way, man is just a puppet in the hands of nature, where he can only decide the rate of development but not the route of development. As I've already mentioned, there are three physiographic divisions: the Himalayan uplands, the Indo-Gangetic plains, and the peninsular India. You can see that the Himalayas, the lofty Himalayas on the north, the Indo-Gangetic plains below it, and the peninsular India, which has sea on three sides and land on one side, which covers the Deccan Plateau of India. Himalayas are beautified by lot of rivers like Ganga, Brahmaputra, coming from the glaciers of Himalayas. And you'll be surprised to know that because of the plutonic movement, because of the tectonic movement, the Himalayas are rising considerably from time immemorial. Because of this rising, Himalayas can be called the youngest mountains. The alluvium, which is carried down by the rivers, are gathering on the plains and which is making the Indo-Gangetic plains so fertile. Now let's talk more about the Himalayas and the western frontier. It can be divided into three broad units: the Eastern Himalayas, the Western Himalayas, and the Central Himalayas. The Eastern Himalayas run from east of the Brahmaputra River in the north-south, extending from Assam to South China. Whereas the Central Himalayan region extends from Bhutan to Chitral, lies at the edges of the great tableland of Tibet, and therefore there have been trade and interaction between India and Tibet. There has been great routes that connected the Indian plains with Iran and Central Asia through Afghanistan that run through the Gomal, Bolan, and Khyber passes. So there are three passes through which a lot of trade has existed. These routes have brought in traders, invaders, and varied cultural influences all through the historic times of peninsular India. Therefore, Greeks, Sakas, Kushanas, Hunas, and so many others entered India through these Balan Khyber passes. And through this route, even Buddhism and other aspects of Indian civilization entered Afghanistan and Central Asia. Historically, thus, Afghan and Balochistan hills have an important frontier zone. Now let's talk about the Indus Plains. It can be divided into Punjab and Sindh. Punjab, which actually means the confluence of five rivers or five tributaries of Indus River. And therefore Punjab is considered to be very, very fertile. Whereas Sindh can be also known as the Lower Indus Valley, and it is a delta which is geographically between Balochistan Hills on the northwest and the Thar Desert on the southeast. Sindh is situated by the Indus River and produces large quantities of rice and wheat. So the subcontinent's first urban culture during the second millennium BC comprised of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, which was located in Punjab and Sindh. That is, Harappa was located in Punjab and Mohenjo-daro was located in Sindh because of the fertile land that was created by the Indus River. Now let's talk about another region of peninsular India, that is Gangetic Northern India. The Ganga Basin climate is more humid than the Indus region, and the annual rainfall is 50 to 200 centimeter. So the Ganga Plain also can be divided into three regions: the Upper Gangetic Plain, the Middle Gangetic Plain, and the Lower Gangetic Plain. The Upper Gangetic Plain is also known as Doab, and it is present in today's Allahabad, which is also known as ancient Prayag. The Upper and Middle Gangetic Plain are geographically defined by the Himalayas on the north and central Indian hills on the south. The Lower Plains are along with the province of Bengal, and the Ganga Plains have nurtured greater number of settlements, have sustained a large population density because of the fertile land. The middle Ganga Plains correspond to eastern Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. This is where ancient Khosla, Kasi and Magadh were situated. And the lower plains are actually with the central Indian hills on the south. That is towards the south, you can see. Now let's talk about eastern, western and central India. We have already talked about Indus Plains, the Gangetic Northern Plains and the Himalayas. So now we come to the eastern, western and central India. Central India is comparatively hilly. It has got lot of badlands, that is lot of topography is there, lot of hills are there, they are intersected by valleys, there are slopes, that is it's uneven totally, which makes it a badland. However, the Aravallis in the northwestern part of this physiographic division extends from southwest to northeast. The Aravallis, that is the ancient Aravallis, almost divides the Rajasthan, that is the desert state. Because of this hilly area, that is which forms the eastern, western and central India, it has not been inundated with lot of administration or lot of changes in the administration. I mean to say that lot of kings have not ruled that part because of the bad terrain. The southeastern part of the state, to the east of the Aravallis is also known as Malwa, where the Malwa culture flourished. Now let's talk about the peninsular India, that is the Deccan Plateau, which is said to be the ancient part, the most ancient part of the peninsular India, which is surrounded on three sides by sea. It comprises of today's Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Maharashtra, forms the Deccan Plateau. It is flanked by eastern and western Ghats on both the side. Telangana, which is also known as the land of Tangs, is also a part of this peninsular India. The extreme south, Deccan Plateau, can be fragmented into isolated blocks, which is known as Nilgiri or the Cardamom Hills. They are roughly divided into eastern and western coastal plains. Though the rivers here in the extreme south, that is Kaveri, is a seasonal river, however, the district, that is this extreme south portion, produces abundance of rice. And even in the ancient Pallava and Chola times, this region depended not on Kaveri River but on tank irrigation system, and therefore they produced huge amount of millets, pulse, oilseeds, etc. Geographically, culturally and linguistically as well, this region is highly evolved. The western coastal plains in the extreme south, which is known as Malabar, which is at present the Kerala state, produces rice, pepper, spices, not just today, but since post-Mauryan times. And therefore, Kerala, which is open to sea, interestingly, first the Christian and then the Muslim came to influence Kerala through the sea. So we see that the extreme south portion of India is so distinct from the other portion because of its geographical location, because of its rivers which are seasonal, because of its people who are hardworking and therefore so different from rest of the state. The important topic which I feel in this session is the physical feature of the physiographic division of India. However, you should go through all the topics very thoroughly. To summarize this session, one can say that the physical division of the subcontinent can be roughly correlated with its linguistics. The linguistics emphasizes the cultural identities of the people, and the people present in the different physical divisions have a great variety of taste, a huge variety and array of food habits, a so different sense of dressing, and the sense of dressing actually depends upon the different environmental condition. If you go to Kashmir, people are wearing different type of clothes with firans. If you go to South, they prefer white, they prefer vibrant colors. The Himalayas in the north, the ocean in the south, the heavy rainfall in the eastern part, a little drier on the western parts, makes India so different and so distinct, and the history also emerges with the same distinct flavor. Thank you.